Hey everybody, welcome back to Urban Crest Online. It is so great to have you back again today. Now, I hope you're ready because Pastor Tom is gonna bring a powerful word today about how to finish well. Fellas, there's gonna be a lot of stuff in there for you, but ladies, listen close too. There's so much to be pulled out of this. That means you need to open up your Urban Crest app right now so you can follow along line by line, note by note, and make sure you get all the way to the bottom of the page so you can email those notes to yourself so you can review them anytime you want. It is a really, really cool thing. Now you guys, before we get into the word, obviously we gotta get our hearts right, so let's prepare ourselves in some worship. That means we're gonna stand wherever we are, we're gonna sing, raise your hands to the sky, and give our Lord what He deserves, and that is the best of your praise. I hope you're ready, because I'm ready. Let's go.
Sing a little louder.
Oh, heaven come.
blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God. Washed in his blood, perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching.
Hey, good morning. What does a college term paper, running your very first 5K, that big project at work, and life itself have in common? Well, all of those things in our humanity, we want to finish those very well and finish them strong. Today, we're going to look into God's Word on how to do that. To prepare our hearts and our minds for hearing the Word of God today, I want to read for us a special passage that I pray will be a blessing in your life today. From the book of Joshua, chapter 1, listen to these two verses, verses 7 and 8. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Would you join me in a moment of prayer? Father, I want to thank you for this day that you've created for us. I want to thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that we have to gather ourselves in worship today. I want to thank you for your word today that encourages us, that, Father, spurns us on to do well. And I pray, Father, that as we hear your word today, we would be obedient to whatever your Spirit calls us to do. In this life, we want to finish strong. Give us your grace, give us your mercy, and give us your strength to do that. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, Urban Crest Baptist Church. I pray that you had a great Thanksgiving. And as I come to you this last Sunday in November, I am excited about the message we're going to talk about today. I have been on a journey with the Lord for about the last 4 or 5 weeks. I took a few days off and went down to Florida and played some golf and got alone with God. And it was amazing. When I slowed down a little bit and I was doing something I enjoyed, which is golf and out there with God's creation, it's amazing how God gets a hold of your life and begins to speak with you. And that's where we came with the whole series on fear. And we talked about 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 and 8. God's not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. And Paul went on to say, Timothy, don't be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, nor of me, his prisoner. So I am excited about this text today. Turn to 2 Timothy chapter 4. I thought we were going to chapter 1. No, I threw you for a curveball there. 2 Timothy chapter 4, probably two of the more famous verses in the New Testament. Paul writing to young Timothy and realizing again that his life is going to be gone soon. It won't be long before the Romans march him down the Appian Way, and there they will take his head for the cause of Jesus Christ, and he'll go home. And he realizes, he says, boy, I'm being poured out like a drink offering to the Lord. He knows what's getting ready to happen. In verse 7 and 8, if I can get my reading spectacles on here, he says this, for I have fought a good fight, I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but to also to all who love his appearing. I want to speak briefly this morning on the subject of finishing strong. What will it mean to finish strong? I mean, I turned 64 this last year, and, you know, next year, boy, I'll sign up for Medicare. Wow. It just doesn't seem possible. But one of the things I constantly get asked about, hey, Pastor, when are you going to call it quits? Well, really don't know on that. Every time I say next week, it winds up being 5 years from now. But all I know is I want to finish strong. I want to finish strong, and I want to finish well for the Master. This time of year, especially as we approach the end of the year, every year I'm asked to provide a top 10 list of what I've been reading, books I've been reading, things that have spoken to me this last year and had an impact in my life. And I always love providing the list because reading is one of my major hobbies. Golf is the other, and billiards used to be when I had my own table, but I play some here at the table we have in the youth room, but not like it used to be. So reading and golf's about it for me, and I love to read books. It's just a gift that God gave to me when I was just in the sixth grade. God just kind of gave me this gift of wanting to read books, and I've done it ever since. I have had several books that have made a profound difference in my life. And I list those every year. I have three or four books that I reread every year. Most of them I reread in the month of January, and they never get old. It's kind of like reading the text I just read to you there, or taking the Lord's Supper. I never get tired of reading the verse. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. I mean, that just never gets tiring to me. But there are three books in particular because they've made such a difference in my life. One was a book called The Gift of Forgiveness by Dr. Charles Stanley, written, gosh, back in the late 90s and stuff. But that book on forgiveness has just been huge in my life. And I'll talk a little bit more about it. A second book written by Dr. John Maxwell entitled Failing Forward is one of the books that really, really helped me at a time when I was pretty low. I mean, I'll be honest with you, I was pretty low. And God just opened that up. I actually went to a conference on the subject of failing forward. And then thirdly is a book called The Winning Attitude. And again, the author is John Maxwell. That book speaks to me so much because of many times of the pain you live in. And with multiple surgeries, and Arthur has become my buddy here these last few years. If you don't know who Arthur is, ask your grandma and grandpa. They know him by first name. So arthritis, he's become my buddy. And when you wake up hurting, you go to bed hurting, all of those kind of different things, I have to make sure that I keep my attitude where it needs to be. Because, boy, I tell you, if you're not careful, when you're hurting, pain can really, really, really dominate your life. And so you all out there hurting, the weather's turning right now, I feel the same way. But again, I want to finish really strong. Now, there are other books that have marked my life. And again, the primary book you always want to have mark your life is God's Word. So don't over-spiritualize what I'm saying to you, because I read this book more than I read any other book. So note that. But there's a couple other books that have marked my life, but I don't reread the book necessarily, but I reread a chapter of that book because it spoke to me so much. Here's one, a book called Adopted for Life by Russell Moore. The second chapter is entitled, Are They Brothers? It is, in my opinion, possibly the greatest book I've ever read, greatest chapter I've ever read on the doctrine of adoption and what God did for you and I when he adopted us as the children of God. I've never read anything quite like it. And well, listen, when you get down, if you get that book out and just remind yourself of who you are, you're an adopted son of Jesus Christ, and you're an adult son of Jesus, which means he can never, ever disown you. Once you became an adult son in the Roman Empire, they could not disown the child. Because see, in the adoption process in the Romans, there were three different times. At a certain age, three, certain age, eight. But when you became 12, they had to adopt you as an adult son. They could got out of it. When God spoke about adopting you and I, his has no conditions. Friend, he went right to the adult son. So when you gave your life to Jesus, you're a child of God, and he's going to hold you for all of eternity. Another book that I did with my staff this year that really spoke to me was a book called Drama Free by an author that I'd never read before. Her name is Cindy McMahon. The second chapter is entitled this, Accepting Your Script, Surrendering to God's Great Story. And the key phrase was, this was not what I expected. And sometimes we have to accept the script that God writes for us, even though we wouldn't have written it. I tell God from time to time, God, I don't like your plan. I really don't like your plan. And he always looks down and goes, thanks. I don't need your help, but God, I'm glad he's patient that way. But listen, sometimes God writes a script for you that you don't like, and you've got to accept that role that God has written for you. So that chapter has helped me a lot the last few months, and it was great going through it with my staff. The winning attitude, I mentioned that, chapter 4. A lot of times I'll reread that whole book, but chapter 4 in particular, I love it. Here's what the chapter is entitled. It's hard to soar with the eagles when you have to live with the turkeys. I had to throw that in, excuse me, with it being Thanksgiving this last week, but that chapter speaks so much. Man, it's hard to soar with the eagles when you have to live with the turkeys. And you know what? He tells one story in that chapter that is really a touching story about two brothers that hadn't seen each other in about 20 years. Because of the wars and different things that had happened, they were separated and gone two different directions in Europe to survive. And they had not seen each other in over 20 years. And they're now getting together, and one brother is meeting the other brother in the airport. And all of a sudden, he's not got a picture, he's got anything. When things happened, they had to scatter in different directions. And all of a sudden, he's standing in the airport, and he looks around to his family and says, there he is, and walks up to him and starts greeting him. And when they were done, the one family member said to him, how did you know it was your brother? And here's what he said. He said, because he walked like my father. Listen, I want to finish well, friend. I want to walk like my father walks. As Paul said, hey, follow me as I follow Christ. I talked about the book of Gift of Forgiveness by Dr. Charles Stanley. Chapter 9 on that book is the greatest chapter I've ever read on forgiveness. And it's entitled this, Forgiving Ourselves. To me, that's the hardest person to forgive is me. And so it's a great chapter. He demonstrates it by taking two chairs, sitting down in one chair and the other chair is empty. And you're just unloading and pouring out to God your heart and asking God to forgive me. And it's just an incredible, incredible book. A brand new book that I've been reading recently that has impacted my life, Forgiving What You Can't Forget. The author there is Lisa Turkus. Chapter 9 says, boundaries that help us stop dancing with dysfunction. I mean, I've danced with dysfunction a lot. And I'm so glad there are boundaries that I can put up. See, forgiveness releases our need for retaliation, but sometimes not for the boundaries in our life. But we're able to forgive, and we don't want retaliation. We don't want revenge. We don't want any of that kind of stuff. But there still needs to be a healthy boundary in our life. And so I'm just learning that one. I've just read that book recently, but that one's going to be one that will mark me for quite a while. There's another book that I recommend for men especially, but I'm going to take 3 or 4 points out of this book this morning when I talk about finishing strong. The book is entitled Finishing Strong by Steve Farrar. Steve was one of the guys that, the guys that are listening to this, boy, when Promise Keepers was in its heyday, Steve Farrar was one of the prime speakers for the Promise Keepers movement. And his book, Finishing Strong, he says in that book, there are 4 basic things that are necessary for a guy to finish strong. We have to stay in the scriptures. We have to stay close to a friend. We have to stay away from other women. And we have to stay alert to the tactics of the enemy. And so I want to talk about all 4 of those real briefly. The first one is we have to stay in the scriptures. Paul said, listen, I have fought a good fight. I have guarded the faith. I finished my course. Listen, I pray, guys, as we grow in Christ, and ladies, please understand, even though God has led me just to pour my heart out to guys today, every point that I'm giving you speaks to you just like it does to men. So I'm asking you today to hang in there with me. Stay in the scriptures, in the book. The first absolute requirement for finishing strong is to stay in God's word, to cherish it, to love it. As David said, God, let me hide your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. God, help us to have a passion to read your word, God, and to stay in it. Joshua, when he was getting ready to take over the reins for Moses, how would you like to fill those shoes? Just let that sink in for just a moment. The most humble man ever lived on the planet, it's what God called Moses. one of the greatest leaders ever lived on the planet, and now you got to take his spot. Joshua chapter 1 and verses 8 and 9, listen to what he said. Only be strong, Joshua, and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Moses, if you want to be, or Joshua, if you want to be a great leader and follow after Moses, stick in the book. Meditate upon this thing day and night. When you do it, it will make you prosperous. When you do it, you'll have good success. Man, I don't know about you, but as we're approaching the new year, I want God to prosper me. I want to have good success with God. The term that is used throughout the Bible for the exercise of staying in God's Word is a term called meditation. When Joshua was handed the reins, he was told to meditate in God's Word. One of the best advice I can give to people when they're talking about studying God's Word and something that you can keep it fresh is to every year pick a book of the Bible and really focus on that book that year. That's one I'm going to really camp out in that year. Read it over and over again, that book. Go in there and mark some of the verses that are that speak to you, I guess is the best way I can say it, that kind of jump off the pages. Mark those things. When you go back and reread it again, reread it with a fresh insight and say, all right, God, give me 4 or 5 of these verses. And when he does, write them out on 3x5 cards. Take those 3x5 cards, put them on your car dash. Put it in your refrigerator. All right. Put it near the toilet. Places that you hang out and that you frequent every day, put those cards and kind of just tape them somewhere where you can look at those cards. Remember what Joshua told the people that are out there? Listen, I set before you today life and death. Choose life that you may win. There's a good one to post up. We're going to have all kinds of decisions facing our nation, all kinds of decisions facing us as families in the year 2021. I want to choose life. I want to choose life, and I want to survive, and I want to prosper in the sight of the Lord, not to build me up, but to point others to Jesus Christ through me. And please know what I'm saying when we talk about prospering. Sometimes God just opens the windows of heaven and pours out a financial blessing upon you. Man, what a joy that is. I mean, all of us like that. But I'm not talking about something that's just material. I'm talking about prospering in our soul. Our soul is being built up in the Word of God, and it doesn't matter what comes nigh my dwelling in 2021, I can stand because I've got God's Word as a solid foundation, as a rock. So I need to stay in the book. But the second thing for finishing strong, I need to stay close to a friend. Listen, God never designed you guys, ladies. You were never designed to go walk through this life alone, ever. You need somebody in your life to help hold you accountable. Somebody who will speak in your life. I have 3 or 4 guys that I talk with every month. A couple of them are real long distance that we talk on, just sometimes on the phone. Sometimes we'll just talk through text back and forth. But I get held accountable. I get asked, how's my thought life? I get asked, Tom, are you spending time in the book? Or are you just recycling sermons? What are you doing, Tom? How about your finances? Are you honoring God in your finances? I mean, it's really neat when you allow people to speak into your life. Stay close enough to a friend who loves you enough to tell you when you screw up. Now, that's a Greek word for you. I thought that wasn't a spiritual word. That means I messed up. All right? So understand, I stepped in doo-doo. You need a friend that'll point their finger in the face and say, like Nathan said to David, you're the man. So understand, I need that. Stay close to a friend who will never violate your confidence. You know there's a true friend out there that will tell you the truth, but they won't tell it to anybody else but to you. That's a friend. One of the primary ways The enemy keeps us from moving forward, whether you're a guy or whether you're a gal, is through isolation. If he can isolate you, keep you from the body of Christ, if he can do those things, friend, he's got you, and you're a prime sitting duck for the enemy. Instead of being close to anyone, you start becoming distant to everyone. Instead of being gut level, you begin to shade the truth. And instead of following Christ, you begin to act like you're following Christ. I've played the hypocrite before, so I know that role well. I know the real deal, and I certainly know the phony and the forgery version also. We need each other, and we need each other desperately to make it through in this life, this journey. We need each other to hold each other accountable to our Christian walk. Listen to the book of Hebrews chapter 3, verse 12 and 13. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you harden your heart. Listen, through the deceitfulness of sin. You understand sin is a deceiver? Sin will say to you, you're okay. You don't need that. You don't need somebody speaking in your life. You don't need any help. Man, just tighten up that belt loop and take off running. Listen, none of us are designed to be superheroes. I read a story years ago about Muhammad Ali, and he got on one of the 747s, and a stewardess said to him, Mr. Ali, would you please put your seatbelt buckle on? And he looked at her and he said, listen, Superman don't need no seatbelt. To which the stewardess replied, sir, Superman don't need no airplane. So understand, listen, we need each other. Guys, you need somebody speaking in your life. Ladies, you gotta have somebody speaking in your life. Depression usually hits the man who tries it alone. Numerous people in the Bible dealt with it. Guys like Moses, David, Elijah, Jeremiah, even Paul, just to name a few, dealt with it. There's a lot to be said about depression, but I want to underline one thing. One of the ways you get through a depression and come out of it stronger on the other side is by having a true friend that'll stand by your side. And they'll love you in spite of who you are, and they're going to keep on loving you. They're going to keep on checking up on you. They're going to keep on calling. They're going to keep on emailing. They're going to keep on whatever social media you use. Why? Because they love you, and they want to see you win. They want to see you prosperous. So I got to stay in the book. All right. And so that's the very, very first one. The most important one in my life is to stay in God's word. Secondly, I need to stay close to a friend. Thirdly, and let me speak to guys and gals here, but guys, this is things that God just spoke to my heart. Stay away from other women. I'm telling you, it is an amazing thing anymore how many people I hear of being married 20, 30, 40 years that are getting divorced because somebody else is involved. God help us. First of all, I've been married 44 years and I ain't about to get trained again. Y'all all right? I've been trained once. Donna has me well trained, well groomed, and I ain't going through that again. But that don't mean every now and then my eyes don't wander. That don't mean every now and then I don't think something I ought to think. Job said, listen, I've made a covenant with my eyes that I might not sin against my wife. God, help us to understand. Keep an appropriate distance in your relationship from either men or women, depending on who I'm speaking to right now. If you're a man, keep your distance, your appropriate distance away from other women. Ladies, keep appropriate distance away from other men. Be the man out there who is willing to go the extra mile in commitment to his wife. Please don't be deceived. This is an epidemic, pandemic proportion in the United States of America today. If you want to finish strong, stay close to home. Years ago, James Dobson, and I love Dr. James Dobson, he wrote a video series entitled Turn Your Heart Towards Home. Friend, let me help you on this one. If you got your eyes somewhere else, you need to turn your heart towards home. Whether you're male, whether you're female, I would remind every guy out there that when he looks over to his neighbor's house and he says the grass looks greener over there, there's a septic tank under that yard. There's a lot of poo-poo under that grass. So you got to understand, even though it might look attractive to the eye, here's what the writer of Proverbs said in Proverbs 5, you do not know her. You do not know this is the way to death. This is the way of liars, and you're going to wind up, some your kids are going to call somebody else daddy. Your Christmas is your Thanksgiving. You're going to be all over the place with all the relatives and everybody you got to try to see, all because we couldn't keep our eyes focused on the one that God gave us. As the writer of Ecclesiastes said, let me remember now the wife of my youth. Let me stay close to her. And then finally, he says in his book, Steve Farrar, and he goes in much more detail. I'm just giving you three or four things. He says, stay alert to the tactics of the enemy. I'm telling you, Satan has a plan for your life, and it is to kill, to steal, and to destroy. That plan started working in the Garden of Eden, and it continues to work today. You see, Adam and Eve, they thought when they took of that fruit, man, they were going to move up in the world. Listen, they thought they were going to fall up, not fall down. And if you're not careful, if we're not alert to the tactics of the enemy, we might think, hey, this is great. This is not going to be a problem. And guess what? You wind up falling down because sin has deceived you. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11 says this, lest Satan should take an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Did you hear what he just said? Paul said, we know him. We've known him since the Garden of Eden. We're not ignorant to his devices, but if we're not careful, man, oh man, the sin that so easily besets us, the writer of Hebrews said, could take us down. When Peter wrote some of his last words to us, he wrote this, and he said, listen, in 1 Peter 5, verses 8 and 9, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. You understand? The enemy's job is to devour you. I mean, the picture there is of a lion attacking an animal. And if you've ever seen any of those on the National Geographic Channel or anything else, discover, man, that's brutal. I mean, all of a sudden, limbs are ripped away. An animal is dying right before your eyes. And you understand the what's getting ready to take place. In just a few moments, this animal is going to be gone. That's the enemy's plan for you. He will tear you limb to limb, from arm to arm, if you'll allow him to do it. Resist him, verse 9 says. How? Steadfast in the faith. Steadfast. I mean, man, oh man, you plant your feet, you're standing with other brothers and sisters in Christ, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brothers in the world out there. Listen, we're all in this battle together. If you think that other men aren't battling some of the things you're battling, friend, you are sorely mistaken, and the enemy has deceived you. So understand, I need to stay in God's Word. I've got to stay close to a friend. I've got to have a friend who will stick closer than a brother. I've got to keep my eyes focused on my wife, on my family, because the enemy's out there to steal it from me and to devour them. And I have got to stay alert for the tactics of the enemy. Joshua Holland said, God give us men. A time like this demands strong minds, great hearts, true faith, and ready hands. Men whom the lust of office does not kill. Men whom the spoils of office cannot buy. Men who possess opinions and a will. Men who love honor. And men who will not lie. God help us, guys. Ladies, God help you and I. Let's finish strong. This next 3-4 weeks, they're all going to talk about what is their New Year's resolution. Man, you know, you're supposed to make that before January 1st. And people will make, and they tell us 90% of them are broken by January 7th. 90% of them. All right? Most of them's a diet, something like that. Mine's broken the next day. All right. I'll go buy a box of cookies and just call my name and I give in. Okay. So it's not much on that one. But here's what I wanted to make the New Year's resolution. I'm going to finish strong. I'm going to finish strong. I couldn't tell you how many people I've talked to in the last couple of weeks here in Lebanon. I bumped in the stores that I don't know the right terminology. They used to come to church. They used to be on fire for Jesus. They used to be. And when I'll stop and talk to a man, I miss you. It's good to see you. Hey, you know where we live, man. Come back and see us. You know you're welcome. I've had that conversation. I couldn't tell you with how many people I've had it in the last, just last 2 or 3 weeks. And it breaks my heart because people are out there and they're going, they're scattered everywhere. And the enemy is there to devour. Let's finish strong. Let's keep our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Father, I love you today. Thank you, Jesus, for speaking into my life. Lord Jesus, thank you. You love me so much that you won't let me get off course. And I thank you so much for that. And Lord, I do pray. I pray, first of all, for anyone who might be listening. They don't know our Savior. Father, I want to praise you for this last Sunday night and all those folks giving their life to Jesus as our Baskets of Hope service, Lord. All of those hands going up, saying yes to Jesus for the first time. And I pray right where people are sitting right now, they've heard the gospel today. It's about the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. It's about keeping our eyes on Christ, because He alone is the author of salvation. I pray right now, if someone needs to say yes to Jesus, they'll pour their heart out to you right now. Jesus, preacher's right. I need you. I give you my life. I'm trusting you as my Savior and as my Lord. My eternal destination is in your hands, Jesus. Change me. Save me. But Lord, for we who know you, and Lord, I think this could be a wake-up call in a lot of our lives today. May it have that effect where we get a wake-up call to say, I want to finish well. I want to finish strong. I want to finish honoring Jesus Christ. I want to finish honoring my family. I want to finish honoring my church. God help us in this age that we live in of deception everywhere by the enemy. Help us to keep our mind focused on you, to stay in your word, stay close to a friend, keep our eyes pure. And Father, help us to stay alert, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, folks. Hey, if you got a question, if we can help you, go to those chat rooms, go fill those cards out. We love you. We're praying for you in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Tom, for that amazing word. Now, you guys, you know what it is. Every week here at Urban Crest Online is Pastor Appreciation Week. So that means It's time to get in those comments right now and give a big amen or a thank you, Pastor Tom, or how about hallelujah? I hope your spell checker works. I don't even know how to spell that, but you can put that in the comments as well. I'm going to give you just a few seconds to do it. Do it now. I hope you did it. Now, at this point in the service, we wanted to offer you the opportunity to give, but of course, we want to encourage you with some of what your generosity has been doing in the world at large. Let's talk about Operation Christmas Child. This is a little update. Because of our members, we will now be delivering over 500 shoeboxes that are going to be sent all over the world. And guys, we're talking 500 plus Christmases that are going to be that much brighter because of you. So thank you guys so much for your generosity, and God bless you as you are praying through your decisions on how to serve with your time, your talent, and your treasure. As you make those decisions, it's very, very easy to give. Just do one of the things you see right here. Easy as that. Now you guys, thank you so much for coming, for joining us. It's amazing to have you every week as we do these amazing services. Man, our pastors are amazing. I hope you enjoy worship. And if you do, click the like button. Subscribe to the channel and definitely hit that notification bell so you receive notifications when we are online and doing the great things that we get to do because of God's generosity. How cool is that? You guys, I'm gonna let you go. We will miss you. Come back again next week. Until then, be good. See you next time. Bye.